This is the Farmers Union Insurance Bison Football Pregame Show.
The Bison coming off their first loss of the year last week to South Dakota State on a last-second touchdown. Not this play, but this was big. Giving up possession of the Dakota marker for the first time in 7 years. This week, the Bison turn their attention to another ranked opponent, the 5-1 Western Illinois Leathernecks, as Missouri Valley Football Conference play is in full swing. That hurts seeing that Dakota marker go down south. Hello and welcome into the Farmers Union Insurance Bison Football Pregame Show. I'm Alex Egan alongside Ryan Gellner. Last week was something that was not good. That was a game that you could see kind of coming from the start of it. South Dakota State comes in here and really it was Taryn Christian, the quarterback for South Dakota State, the quarterback run game really beating the Bison. We didn't see this before South Dakota State came to the Fargo Dome this year.
Nah, but we talked about it. We knew Taryn Christian could run and would run in this football game. We didn't know that he would run as much as he did and as effectively as he did. The Bison defense has been good for years. There is one area that they have been susceptible in, and it's been quarterback run year after year after year. South Dakota State waited to show their card. They showed it. North Dakota State, I think for all intents and purposes, was not ready for it. And they simply got beat. Big deal. Number three ran all over the Bison last week. And uh-oh, another running quarterback again this week.
We will talk more about the running quarterback for Western Illinois, but this is a game this week that is very, very big in terms of the conference standings, in terms of the overall morale of the team coming off of a loss. What do you see?
It's huge. Western Illinois is 5-1 on the season. They might be the scariest 5-1 team. They might be the only unknown 5-1 team in the country right now because nobody seems to be talking about Western Illinois and what they're doing so far in this season, but they're a good football team. They can throw it all over the place. They can play a little bit of defense. They've got some excellent skill position players that we'll talk about in just a little bit, but here's a football team that is just flying under the radar in North Dakota State now, has to get back on track and got to go back to what they do well, and that's running the football, controlling the offensive line, doing some of the things that have made North Dakota State as good as they have been all these years.
We'll talk about that. Western Illinois is a ranked opponent. Let's take a look at the Bison schedule so far. And it's been one that has, well, seen a lot of ranked opponents. I mean, Charleston Southern ranked, Eastern Washington ranked, Iowa ranked in the FBS, Illinois State, they were ranked when they came into the Fargo Dome. Missouri State is the only team on this schedule right now that was not ranked when the Bison played them. South Dakota State ranked in the top 15. This Western Illinois team ranked in the top 20. So we're seeing that the Bison are playing a very, very tough schedule.
Throw out the top and the bottom. These next four games for North Dakota State make or break the season. They put them into the playoffs wherever they're going to be put. These next four games, circle every single one of them because they are absolutely huge. This is the fun part of the year.
An interesting part. This game, North Dakota State and Western Illinois, is the final game of the day for the Missouri Valley Football Conference. There was some interesting matchups between some of the teams that are still on the schedule for the Bison. We'll tell you about some of those matchups coming up at halftime and how those games came up. But it's an interesting stretch on the road today at Western Illinois. And then you go on the road to Northern Iowa. Northern Iowa today put up over 60 points on Missouri State. So that's they are showing what they've got to offer today, and they did it with their backup quarterback.
Not bad. Backup quarterback might be now starting quarterback. Yeah. South Dakota State also is going to lead this league now. Yep. Going into the second half of the season, and everybody now trying to chase South Dakota State. So it is what the Missouri Valley Football Conference is, and that's the powerhouse in the top couple of teams. But we've seen that powerhouse now get a little bit closer. There's more teams that are on the power side of this conference. North Dakota State in not really a must-win situation, but it sure would be nice if North Dakota State could win today to put themselves in the upper echelon of the conference going into the big stretch now.
And North Dakota State isn't bad coming off of a loss. We'll tell you about that as we get into the show as well today. It's the Bison and the Leathernecks on the road in Macomb, Illinois. We'll break down the matchup. Plus, we've got a whole lot more for you. We'll sit down and talk with Jack Plankers. We'll go down memory lane with Travis Beck. That will be a good, good time.
It'll be fun.
The show is just getting started, folks. We're here right up till kickoff. It's the Farmers Union Insurance Bison Football Pregame Show. some of the scenes from Macomb, Illinois, as the Bison and the Leathernecks get ready to kick off in under an hour. I will say this, I think the people in Macomb are a little bit more interested in the game that's taking place in Northern Illinois.
Is there a baseball game?
I think there's a baseball game going on. The Cubs and the Dodgers.
Go Bison.
Yeah, go Bison. Welcome back inside the Farmers Union Insurance Bison Football Pregame Show. Good job, kids.
Bison horns.
Yeah, put them up. Let's go out to Beth Houle in the tailgating area from Macomb. Hey, Beth, how you doing?
Hey, guys, out here in the tailgate lot in Macomb, Illinois, found some guys who actually live in Iowa right now. It's one of the few groups of people that are probably excited for a Macomb, Illinois road trip for the Bison. A little closer for you guys?
Oh, yeah, definitely.
How many guys do you have out here with you? How big is this road trip for you guys?
Just a group of four for us, but obviously there's a lot more than that out here.
Are you surprised how many are out here?
Yeah, kind of.
It's a tough trip. It's tough to get here. You guys, yes, you guys are out here tailgating the old school way, guys. We see all kinds of shenanigans up in Fargo, but we're tailgating on a tailgate of a truck out here. Sometimes it's best just to play it simple, huh?
Pretty much. Simpler is easier.
You're a man of many words.
Why not?
You got the shot ski going here.
Gotta have a shot ski.
What's the shot of choice for this group of guys?
They like the egg. I like the apple, crown apple.
Ooh, nice. Mixing it up out here in Macomb, Illinois, guys. We've got plenty more tailgaters to come. Go ahead and stick with us. We'll be back from Macomb.
All right. Thank you very much, Beth. You know, sometimes simpler is better.
What's the next step there for Beth? She wants their choice, but she doesn't go with her choice.
We hope that Beth will be joining us later on in the show.
Good night, Beth.
she will be on the sidelines, I'm being told. We mentioned the struggles of the running game against South Dakota State. Oh, yeah. It was not good. If you take away Easton Sticks, 92 yards and two touchdowns, it was not an easy day for the Bison backfield. Take a look at this graphic that we have here for you. King Frazier struggled to run the ball. Longest of 7 yards. He on 13 carries, just 45 yards. Bruce Anderson, 4 carries, 13 yards. He went out with an injury, but his long was only 6 yards. Chase Morlock only getting the ball twice. Lance Dunn getting the ball 4 times. Those two combining for 17 yards. 23 carries, 75 yards for the Bison running backs. That's not exactly the key to success for NDSU.
NDSU put an emphasis on running the football into practice this week. No doubt about it. The Bison, they need to control the line of scrimmage, and they need to win the time of possessions. Two things they did not do against South Dakota State. Now, NDSU said all the right things. They gave credit to South Dakota State. But I think when you watch the film, NDSU just didn't play very well up front. I think a lot of this is not credit to South Dakota State. I think a lot of this is NDSU just didn't show up. They didn't show up offensively on the offensive line. The running backs didn't hit the holes hard. And that is not South Dakota State pushing them back. That's NDSU not opening up holes. And if that doesn't happen, NDSU isn't going to win football games. There's no second level blocking there. If that happens, NDSU is not going to win football games. And there was a good focus on the Bison trying to run the football in practice this week. And we'll see how it carries over. It really is now on the front five for North Dakota State and to its running backs. And I know that's a little bit not what you want to hear. Right. You want to hear South Dakota State took that game. But when you look at film, I don't know that NDSU gave it their best shot.
It definitely wasn't the type of running game that we saw even the previous week at Missouri State, where the Bison wore down the Bears, and they were able to just take over that football game in the third and fourth quarters. We did not see that this past week at South Dakota State. And I know that Coach Polasek, who is in charge of the running backs, will make sure that his running backs have a good week this week.
And it's a big thing because Western is fourth in the nation in time of possession. North Dakota State doesn't need to win the time of possession, but they can't let Western Illinois dominate. How do you do that? Well, you run the football, and that's been the success for North Dakota State. Get the time of possession on your side, or at least closer to the middle if you have a shot at winning this game.
Okay, so we've talked about the loss, but losing hasn't always been such a bad thing for the Bison. Let me show you what I'm talking
about.
Explain that. In the last 5 seasons, the Bison have 6 losses, but they have responded in a big way. In 2011, the Bison lose at home to Youngstown State by 3 points, mind you. Take a look at these loss margins. Mm-hmm. They're not very big. But then they come out the next game, and they beat Western Illinois at Western Illinois, put up 37 points to just 21. That 21 was the most points that they gave up following the loss last year. That was the most points that they gave up en route to their first national championship. In 2012, they lose at home against Indiana State by 3. They go on and win by 54 points on the road at South Dakota. The anomaly, a little bit of a weird one. 2014, we'll remember this. 23-3, the loss at Northern Iowa. But then the next week, 45-10, a win at Missouri State. In 2015, it was the same story, just add in a second loss. They lose last second play at Montana, come back and dominate Weber State at home. And then on the last second field goal to South Dakota, they come back in Easton Stick's first start and controlled that game against Indiana State and double them up.
Those two losses in 15 on the last play of the game, the loss last week on the last play of the game, the last three losses North Dakota State has had on the last play of the game. They haven't lost two in a row since 2009. So you're right, this team bounces back 12 straight times after a loss. That's pretty good.
Yeah, that is really good. It's not about what had happened, it's about what you do with it.
And no doubt about it, this game, rear view mirror.
Yeah,
they're not talking at all about it today. It doesn't factor into today's game at all.
Let's put it to bed, why don't we? And let's move on and we'll talk about Western Illinois. We'll hear from the voice of the Leathernecks, Scott Kornberg, and we'll break you down who is the players to watch on the Leathernecks. That's all next right here on the Farmers Union Insurance Bison Football Pregame Show. Three, two, one. Welcome back into the Farmers Union Insurance Bison Football Pregame Show. Alex Egan, Ryan Gellner here. Each week we like to get you a little bit more involved and to know the opposing team. We welcome in the voice of the Leathernecks, Scott Kornberg, joining us from Hanson Field out there in Macomb. And Scott, thank you so much for joining us.
Well, Alex and Ryan, thanks so much for having me on. Hopefully we'll get a good game tonight.
Yeah, the weather there looks pretty nice. Speaking of pretty nice, this Western Illinois team, they have been doing some good things. What has Coach Fisher done in his short time there with the program?
Well, I think one of the biggest thing is he's brought in a brand new offense, and part of that was entrusting a new quarterback to run that. I think a lot of people were surprised that Trenton Norvell, all-conference caliber quarterback, who had started his first 3 years in the program, was a guy who is not the starting quarterback this year, and instead it's Sean McGuire, who is Norvell's injury replacement last season. But Sean McGuire was able to learn the new offense better, and Charlie Fisher has really entrusted literally every single thing to him, from calling all the plays in the huddle, reading the defense, making audibles, signaling hot routes, whatever it is. And he's just a sophomore now. This will be his 11th start of his career, so he's still very, very young, essentially what you would have at the end of a freshman season in terms of starts. But he's really taken off with it. I think that's the biggest thing. They run a fairly similar defensive scheme, but the offense is very different, but it has worked out really, really well.
I would assume that offense watches some tape, and if they watched tape last week of North Dakota State, they saw Taryn Christian run all over North Dakota State with some of the read option stuff and some of the design quarterback runs. Sean McGuire happens to be a dual threat quarterback. Do you think you see him not only try to chuck the ball against North Dakota State, but use his legs and run against the Bison as well?
Yeah, you know, I actually asked that to Coach Fisher over the week, and I said, this Bison running defense is great. They're 10th in the nation. Obviously, that's a huge part of Western Illinois' game, is that they have to run the football to be successful, because so much of their passing game is predicated on, can they get play actions? Can they get their quarterback rollouts and have the running game be effective enough? And do you at least have the threat of a run? And he said, you know, we do have to run it a lot with our running backs. We trust Steve McShane. We trust Jamie Gilmore. We really love our offensive line. But he said, yeah, I just watched Taryn Christian run for 141 yards against these Bison. And Western Illinois has run quite a bit of quarterback draws, quarterback sweeps this year, a little bit of read option here and there. It would stun me if they don't go to that really a lot in today's game, because they really need to establish the run for their offense to be successful.
Scott Kornberg, the voice of the Leathernecks. Thank you so much, Scott. Great information there. Have a great call today.
Thanks for having me on, guys. Appreciate it.
Thanks, man. And there he is. That is Sean McGuire, the 6'3" sophomore quarterback from Wisconsin. He is dual threat, no doubt about it. Another dual threat quarterback for the Bison. Throws for nearly 260 yards a game. That ranks 17th nationally, creeping up on 3,000 career passing yards. He's got a 70-yard touchdown run, Alex, and also a game where he has 168 rushing yards in the second half. Now, you heard about Western Illinois. They will call designed quarterback runs. They will call different plays to get the quarterback and his feet making plays on the football field. He's another good one.
I think the number to pay attention to, though, is the touchdown to interception ratio. 10 touchdowns, 5 interceptions. So he's thrown that he's shown that he doesn't really make great decisions. He's still only a sophomore, but the Bison Ball Hawks could be, you know, out
there. You're saying there's a chance.
I'm saying there's a chance. That is what I'm saying. Let's take a look at their stud wideout, and it's Lance Lenoir. He is something special.
Seems like he's been around forever.
Right? In his 19th year, Lance Lenoir. No. The 6-foot senior, 210 pounds out of Illinois, Crete, Illinois. Putting up another great season, 45 catches. He's got 759 yards, well on his way of another 1,000-yard receiving season. He averages 16.9 yards per catch. So whenever he's getting the ball, he's making things happen, and they're big plays. It's explosive plays basically every time he catches the ball. Only the 4 touchdowns, though, so we've seen that he hasn't been so effective at getting into the end zone, but he's averaging over close to 130 yards a game.
No surprise that he leads the conference, 3rd in the nation with those 127 receiving yards a game. 3 times he's gone over 100 yards so far this season. Obviously leads the conference in receptions. They'll get him involved not only in the air, watch him on a jet sweep as well. They like to get number 7 the football in space.
So you shut down the quarterback, you shut down the receiving game, and then, oh yeah, you've got a 3rd option for the Leathernecks on offense. Steve McShane, the running back, he is also a sophomore. So 2 young guys featured prominently in this offense for head coach Charlie Fisher in his first year there at Western Illinois. 185 pounds, so he's a little bit of a smaller guy at 5'8", 185. You're not going to see him, you know, make those bruising runs by any means, but 650 rushing yards. He's averaging over 5 yards a carry, and that is very efficient running of the football.
He leads the conference with 108 rushing yards. Looks like a center fielder, doesn't he?
Yeah, he does.
You know why I say that? Because earlier last year, 4-for-10 against the Bison in baseball. Played center field, started 3 times for Western Illinois. The kid's a baseball player as well. Dual sport athlete, obviously can get it done.
And they use him out of the backfield receiving as well. He's got those 16 catches for 138 yards.
9 stolen bases, 2 triples, if you were wondering.
What sport did you do your research on?
Baseball pregame show.
We'll stick to football for now. It's getting too cold to play baseball, I can tell you that much. We have plenty more to come for you here on the Farmers Union Insurance Bison football pregame show. We will talk football, true. I promise. As we move forward here today, as the Bison and the Leathernecks get set to play, just about over a half an hour until we get you set out to Macomb for kickoff. Stay with us. Welcome back inside the Farmers Union Insurance Bison football pregame show. The atmosphere seems to be pretty fun out there in Macomb, and Beth Houle, the 3rd member of our team, has caught up with some pretty special folks in the tailgate area there in Macomb. Beth.
Hey guys, we're out here in the tailgate lot in Macomb, Illinois. Found Nate Tangway's parents, 2 of my favorites out here every year, because Nate is such a great kid. We got to talk to him this week. We're doing a story on him for the coaches show this week on his major in broadcasting. Clearly, I haven't scared him away from it.
No, but he's following in your footsteps. That's what he said. I want to follow Beth and find out where she's going.
I'm sure. Absolutely. I don't doubt you at all in that. But right. What have you heard from him about getting to major in such a fun major?
One of the things that he talked about was his professors. He's got a great couple professors that really enjoy him and the camaraderie between them. And he's picked up on the classes and he just absolutely loves it. It's been fun for him.
When you talk to Nate about his experiences in it, what's he saying to you about it? What's it like for him to get his hands involved and go out there and shoot sports after playing them for so long?
I can't answer that. Ask Brian.
He wants to be a part of it. That's his entire life. He's from the time he was 2 years old, he's been in sports, and he loves to talk about it. He loves to break it down, and he loves broadcasting. He's not a shy guy. He's
what?
Not at all. He'll talk to anybody, and he'll talk all day long about it. He gets that from his mom, as you can tell.
No, not at all.
But he enjoys, he really enjoys breaking down games, breaking down, you know, who's doing what, and he's a film geek. to be honest with you. So
you guys are out here. It's been a tough week for the Bison football team after the difficult loss last week. Have you heard from Nate? I mean, he's certainly a driven guy. How ready is he to be back on the football field?
He's excited about it. He said, you know, it was a letdown, you know, but they lost in the last couple of seconds, and that's going to happen. He said they worked just as hard as NDSU does to win games. And he said, we're going to come out this week. He said, we're going to focus a little bit tighter. And he said, we're going to have a great game. And he's got a lot of good captains around him, a lot of good senior leadership. And I think they'll succeed this week.
Can I at least get a go Bison from you?
Go Bison.
There we go. Thank you. All right, guys, check out that Coach's Show story tomorrow on the Coach's Show statewide. Nate Tanguay going to have a bright future ahead of him coming after our jobs, guys. So look for that.
Thanks, Beth. He's only a junior, so I at least have two more years before he ousts me from this spot. Each week here on the pregame show, we like to get to know the players a little bit more than just a jersey number under a helmet. I caught up with senior O-lineman Jack Plankers, who he didn't have a hard decision picking the Bison out of high school in this week's Beyond the Game. Jack, first off, you're from the area. So coming to Fargo, coming to NDSU, that was probably a pretty easy decision for you.
Yeah, NDSU was one of the only bigger schools to recruit me. I got a couple of things from Wisconsin, but driving, you know, 8 hours or so to go to school was not quite an option for me, so NDSU was a logical choice there.
And so you come to NDSU, you get to play on the offensive line. You've gotten to play against and with some NFL players. Can you kind of walk me through what that experience has been like, you know, playing against guys like Kyle and with guys like Carson?
Coach Bowl always said, as iron sharpens iron, one man sharpens another, and Kyle Emanuel was kind of my iron for a very long time. He's a heck of a player, and he's still doing real well. And he was a pretty good guy to work against. And he's probably a lot of my success here is due to that.
Let's go into the classroom. You have industrial engineering as a major. Mm-hmm. How does that come about?
I not necessarily the most glamorous of majors. How I got to that was, I was just kind of looking through a list of majors and saw that engineers made quite a bit of money starting out of college. And I'm like, well, I'm good at math, so here we go. And it just kind of started from there.
And then you have minors in psychology and business. So I'm curious of how all three of those are very different realms of possibility. So how do you get to an industrial engineering major, psychology minor, business minor? How does that come about?
Industrial engineering has a lot to do with working with people and processes simultaneously. So the psychology degree kind of helps me to, you know, figure out what'll motivate an employee or what'll allow me to communicate effectively with someone to get a change made or start a new process or something like that. And then business is making educated decisions that affect the bottom line. It's always nice to have a little bit of a business background so I can understand what decisions to make and what way to go.
So when you're done here at NDSU, what is the plan for you?
That's a little up in the air at the moment. I don't know as if I could give you a 100% concrete answer on that one. We'll see where this football thing goes, and then engineering's looking pretty good at the moment too, so we'll see.
You are kind of a talkative guy, and I know we've talked before about some of the exchanges that you have on the field with some of the players, but what are you like in the locker room around some of your teammates, and what are you hearing from your teammates about your style of play and of leadership and just your personality?
The way I've kind of asserted leadership here is more of the one-on-one, just sit down and talk to you before the game. Let's each person individually, I try to motivate them a little bit. I'm not necessarily the big get up in front of the group, a rah-rah guy. That's more Nate. You can talk to Tanguay on that one.
Can we talk about the beard?
Absolutely.
Why did you grow it to begin with?
Mostly because I ran out of razors and they're pretty expensive to replace. And then secondly, just I'm losing it a little bit up top, hence the hat. So it's trying to flaunt what I got left.
Hey, I can relate to the lack of hair up top. I got you there. We are buddies in that follically challenged group.
Yep, the hairline's fighting the good fight, but it's losing the battle a little bit.
That is so true. I can relate to you there. So the beard, how long have you been growing it out?
I was clean shaven on May 15th for a job interview at Sanford, and then from there I just kind of let her ride.
On May 15th, so this is only like what, 4 months, 5 months of growth?
Yeah, right around in there.
That's impressive.
I think we just hit five a couple of days ago.
Very good. Well, Jack, it's always a joy to talk to you, and best of luck to you. I'm sure you guys will come back out and be ready to go against Western this week.
Absolutely. Thank you very much.
I could talk to Jack for hours and hours and hours. Oh, and of course, we get him right when he takes his helmet off. That is an impressive beard, though. 5 months of growth.
The Halloween costumes that he could go as are endless. That is amazing.
Jack has been playing for a couple years. You heard, you know, Kyle Emanuel was his iron there. He's gone up against some really great players every day in practice. He's practiced alongside some really great players. And Jack is, you don't want to say that you have favorites, but Jack is one of my favorite people to talk to on the team.
One of the good guys on that football team, that's for sure. And there's a lot of them.
Yes.
But yeah, he is so personable and so fun to be around. Just kind of welcomes you into the room.
Yeah.
He's a great guy with a solid beard.
Solid beard, yes, that is true. All right, we're going to step aside. When we come back, we're going to walk down memory lane with Ryan and Travis Beck. Stay with us right here on the Farmers Union Insurance Bison Football Pregame Show.
Welcome back in, about 20 minutes away from kickoff at Western Illinois. Think back when North Dakota State reached its first national championship game in 2011 in that season. No one really knew what to expect. 5 years later, every Bison fan knows where Frisco is and what that means. When you think back to Frisco 1, more than likely two plays stand out. The Matt Voigtlander fake punt and an interception by redshirt freshman Travis Beck. We look back at the pick in this week's So Once a Bison. Travis, I think when we look back at your career, I think still, at least in the people that understand football, understand what Travis Beck meant to this team. People that are casual fans, I don't think really have any idea of how big of a football player you were, how fast, how disruptive you were on defense. Let's look back at the 2011 National Championship game. That's National Championship 1.
Yeah.
Young buck, redshirt freshman, 19 years old. And man, do you make a play.
Some long hair there, yeah.
You do make a play in this football game. Your team is ahead 10-6. It's getting late in the football game, and you guys need a play. Brian Bell drops back to pass. You start out in what looks like man coverage. Actually, it's zone coverage. He never even sees you.
Yeah, well, got to credit Levon Perry on that. He put his guy right in Brian Bell's face. And, yeah, he must not have seen me because he threw it right at me. All I remember was thinking, you better not drop this ball because he chucked it right at you. So
you make the pick down on the 36. First career interception, by the way.
Yeah.
You make the pick. You start heading down the sideline. First, Christian Dudzik comes across the field and gets an absolute gorgeous hit on the intended receiver.
Yeah, that receiver, he was their fastest guy, too. So, I mean, he would have caught me instantly. So Dudzik hit him, so I started running. I remember all I could hear was Levon Perry had this block. I just remember just hearing a big crack.
Decleater.
Oh, yeah, because it was a big offensive lineman. That guy took the day off after that. I think he was still on. He might have took him off on a stretcher, but I don't know. And those were the two big blocks, and then me and Cole just ran down the sideline, except quarterback.
Yeah, except the quarterback. Now, hold on. You weren't carrying the ball in your right hand.
Left hand.
You're carrying the ball in the left
hand.
You're a
more
former
natural
high school quarterback, and you're a former high school running back. You know better than
I'm
this.
I'm a fullback. They didn't give me the ball. I was blocking.
But instinct takes over in a little bit because Cole's out in front of you.
Talk to Matthews about that.
Yeah. Cole's out in front of you.
Yeah.
And Brian Bell, their quarterback, who Levon puts onto the ground, ends up getting to his feet, and he's coming from the outside. Let's go through this. The last 10 yards here. First of all, what are you hearing?
I'm hearing myself breathe because I was gassed out pretty much, so I didn't hear much, so except that block by Levon. That was about it.
So you're running down the field, and when do you see the quarterback Bell, number 11, coming? Because he's taking a pretty wide angle.
I saw him probably about 2015, I remember, and I was thinking, quarterback, he's probably going to go low. So.
And that's when you switch hands.
Probably.
Just inside the 10-yard line. Now you know you might get hit on this
thing.
So the quarterback comes in, and then about the 5-yard line, I think both you made a decision and he made a decision at the same time.
Yeah, yeah. Because I remember he went low.
Yeah, he comes flying in low. Like this.
So I'm like, I should have enough room here. So I tried to stretch it in.
You tried a Superman.
Yeah. Looking back, I probably should have jumped and then landed on my feet. But I don't know. I haven't jumped over many people. I'm not Andrew Bonnet or anything. So I don't know.
So you end up head, ball.
I think the ball landed right about
half yard line.
Yeah, somewhere in there. I'm just glad. Yeah, if it was a fumble, though, Scott Skolchinski was running it down, too. So he landed on it. But I think they gave me half yard line. Yeah. Then yeah. Brock ran it in.
One play later, Brock runs it in. Gets all the credit.
Hey, that's fine with me. That's all right.
When you look back, your first interception on the big stage like that, I mean, that's awesome.
Yeah, it was a good moment for team and everyone. I'm glad I didn't drop it. So,
is it hard to believe now? You fast forward 5 straight national championships and this year's team going for another one. Is it hard when you look back and you think about young freshman Travis Beck and start thinking about where this team is now? Is it hard to believe they've done that, or yeah, did you see some of this coming?
I mean, you knew that we could do it, but I mean, I'm not gonna be pretty cocky to say we're gonna win 5 and have a chance for 6 and 7 or 8, but I mean, I just did not see the 5 in a row, I will say that. But we saw the first maybe 2 or 3 coming, I think, after Eastern beat us and then they won, we thought we could do the same. So,
and there you did. This year with the interception, you run it down the sideline, seal the deal on that football game. Brock scores, your national champions, and the rest is certainly history for North Dakota State. It is, it's been an awesome run for NDSU, and when we look back at National Championship 1, we'll remember Travis Beck's interception forever. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, pretty cool.
Travis Beck, once a Bison.
Always Bison. Thank you.
Thank you, buddy. How do you not like
that's
Travis
that's
Beck?
Fun.
A lot of off-the-cuff stuff Mr. Beck. It's too bad he got injured. 308 career tackles, and I think he had a future in front of him. And then, of course, the injury happens. But injuries, they're part of football. Fun stuff with Travis Beck.
Very good stuff with Travis Beck. Speaking of injuries, we're going to tell you who's listed on the injury report as we step aside one final time. We'll get you that information next on the Farmers Union Insurance Bison Football Pregame Show. Welcome back inside the Farmers Union Insurance Bison Football Pregame Show. We are just about 10 minutes away from kickoff between the Bison and the Leathernecks. Let's tell you who is and who is not playing for the Bison. Here is who is listed on the Bison Injury Report. Cornerback Jalen Wimbush is probably the biggest name on this. He left the game against SDSU with concussion symptoms. I'm told he was practicing this week, but he was no contact during practice. He's officially questionable, and they'll make a game-time decision to see if he is good to go. The one that we kind of all saw, Bruce Anderson, suffering an injury to the same ankle he injured earlier in the season. Make what you will if you saw the play. Mm-hmm. He is out today, and Eric Perkins is still also out with a hand injury. So that opens the door on the return game for Ty Brooks, the freshman, redshirt freshman, getting his opportunity here for the Bison Fargo South product with both Anderson and Perkins out. Let's go out to Beth Houle, standing by with Dr. Bruce Pyatt.
Thanks, guys. We're here for our Sanford Orthopedic Sports Medicine Injury Report, joined by Dr. Pyatt. Something that athletes deal with is the re-injury of something. How much more difficult is it, or is it more difficult to work with an athlete who's re-injured something?
Well, I think from our standpoint, we're always trying to do things to assure that we don't have that re-injury kind of status for them. So when they do get re-injured, the first question we always ask ourselves, have we pushed it too quickly or what have we done? And so it's an individual case, individual body part. Most things we're talking about is that we've gotten them back to playing at a point where we think it's safe, where they've got full range of motion of their joint, they've got full strength back, they have a comfort level with it. And then it really depends on what's happened on the field. If it's really just that they've aggravated something a little bit, like some of the muscle strains and hamstring injuries and things like that, then that probably tells us we have pushed him a little bit more than what the extremity was ready for. We do have a lot of things at our disposal now to try to help us determine that with some of the different strength testing machines and apparatus that we have to help us determine, but sometimes it's still a little bit of guesswork. With some of these other things, though, it may just be bad luck. You know, they're in a sport that puts them at risk anyways, and it may just happen to be that they've got the same injury over again. In that scenario, we tend not to see that things are worsened. It's just more of an aggravation of the same thing. So we tend not to see a more severe injury, which is good from our standpoint because it's just like starting over at day zero, not 10 weeks behind that, you know.
Are there some injuries that are just more prone once they've become aggravated, or is that kind of just a wives' tale?
Well, I think there are some of those things that once you have them, you're going to be more prone throughout life. And obviously, when you're setting yourself up in a sporting event, you're going to be exposing yourself to more opportunity for that. So there are some of those things that really are more prone because they injure they heal with scar tissue, which is not as good as what we started with.
Well, thanks so much for shining some light today, guys. That's another Sanford Orthopedic Sports Medicine Injury Report.
This is the Farmers Union Insurance Bison Football Pregame Show.
Just a few moments away from the kickoff between the Bison and the Leathernecks. Let's go out to Beth Hoole as she is standing by with Bison head coach Chris Kleiman to get his thoughts before his team takes the field.
All right, Coach, coming off the loss last week to South Dakota State, did you see the focus and the progress you needed to see in practice this week?
Well, we had a great week of practice, and we talked about going 1-0 for the week, and today's the biggest day of the week. So I know the guys are really focused throughout the week. We had a good week of practice. Now we just got to go out and execute.
When you're looking at this game, 6 o'clock start, there's a lot of day that's passed right now. How do you make sure this is not an effect on the game?
Well, we've had it's our second 6 o'clock game, I believe. And so, you know, the guys are kind of used to it, and we talked about it, and we did some things this morning at the hotel with some walkthroughs. And then, we have a pretty good bus ride. We had about an hour and 45 minute bus ride down here, but we were down here in plenty of time. Guys are loosened up, and there's no excuses. We got to go play.
Thanks so much, Coach. Good luck today.
All right. Thank you very much, Coach. Thank you, Beth. Our Bobcat heavy lifting player this week, Easton Stick. Can it really be anybody else?
5 quarterbacks have thrown over 240 yards versus the Leathernecks this year. Easton, we'll see how he responds. Now, 13 gets 6 in a career day for Easton Stick today.
Western Illinois has a young secondary, and Easton Stick needs to take advantage of that. And the thing that he said the most after the South Dakota State game was,
"It's on me.
We just didn't make plays."
Mm-hmm.
So, there it is.
He threw 4 touchdowns last year against Western.
One of them was awesome.
Another big game for him, I think, this year.
I really do think that Easton Stick will be the key to this game. Speaking of the keys to the game, the ones that you gave me, continue to improve.
Yeah, continue to improve, especially in the secondary. With Jalen Wimbush now out, we're understanding. Quentin McCoy gets a start, the senior transfer. Also watch for Marquise Bridges. These guys are starting to trust each other, and that's huge for the Bison. The corners are trusting the safety. The safeties are leaning on the corners, and that's huge in the progression of this defense. Up next, it is extend drives. They've got to be able to move the football, control the line of scrimmage, win on first down. Put them in a 2nd and 3 or 4 instead of a 2nd and 9 like last week. That obviously doesn't work. They have to do that.
And to further that point, if the Bison offense gets at least 1 or 2 first downs in their final possession of the game last week against South Dakota State, SDSU doesn't have a chance to put that ball into the end zone.
You're right.
With time remaining.
Extend one drive.
Extending your drives. Yes, extending the drives is very important for them. And then your final one, go 1-0 today.
You just heard Chris Kleiman say it. We've got to go 1-0 on the day. That's the most important thing of this entire list. They've been stressing it all week. Don't let last week's game beat you again this week. Forget it, and I really do think it's done for them. Nothing else matters. Does not matter if they win by 1 or if they win by 31. You've got to go 1-0 today. Win the day.
So earlier in the show, we told you about how good the Bison were coming off of a loss. They're also pretty good at night games as well. They won their first night game this year. What was the did you have that stat readily available?
I don't have it front of me.
I think they won like 20-something, 18 of their last 20.
19 of 20, yeah.
They do pretty well. Yeah, they're pretty good at the 6 o'clock start game. So here are the quarterbacks that are going to be featured today in our quarterback comparison, Easton Stick. He had not his best week last week, and I think he'll be the first one to tell you that. So We already featured him as our heavy lifting player. 130 pass attempts, 83 completions. The completion percentage is still there. Just the 9 touchdowns, though, you'd think that that number has to go up today.
And I think it will. Western allows 301 passing yards a game and over 450 total yards a game. And again, the Bison had 528 yards against this team last year. You'd expect Easton Stick and the Bison to come out and try to make a statement and show everybody in the nation who this Bison football team is.
And if he's not doing it with his arm, he's likely going to be doing it with his feet, although I know Coach Kleiman doesn't really want him taking as many hits as he took like he did last week against South Dakota State, but it was good to see him running the football effectively. Now the running backs need to run the football effectively. On the other side, quarterback Sean McGuire for Western Illinois. We featured his numbers so far. 10 touchdowns, 5 picks. His completion percentage isn't all that great. I mean, 58% is still good, but it's not all that great. And he's hasn't really shown too much of the rushing, but we know he can do it.
And they will. And to me, it's the linebackers for North Dakota State have to keep their eyes ready. They have to keep their eyes straight. That means they'll drop back into coverage, but they have to know where the quarterback is at. If they know where he's at and they allow 4, 5, 6 yards, that's fine. It can't be 15 or 20 yards allowed to the quarterback. He will run today.
30 seconds away until we hand it off to our guys out there in Macomb, Illinois. What do you need to see? What do you need to see in this first quarter of action for the Bison?
Energy. It's the hardest place in the conference to play. It's a bad stadium. It's a bad crowd. You have to walk nearly a mile to get from the basketball stadium where the locker room is to the football field. All that stacked against the Bison. Just come out and play. None of that matters. Come out and play.
Forget last week. Focus on this week.
Yep.
What was it? Go
1-0.
Go 1-0 today. Thank you for joining us on the pregame show. We'll see you back here at halftime.